In the last class, we discussed about technical processing in libraries, right? So moving on from that, today we are going to discuss about circulation section in libraries and what is the role of circulation section. Okay, so far we discussed about acquisition, role of acquisition department, role of technical processing department and technical section department, and now today we are going to see the functions of circulation section. Okay, so we all know that the primary function of circulation section is to issue, return and renew books, right? To keep a record of all those things, right? The circulation section links the library collection to the readers. That is true. Actually, the library is purchasing the books and the readers are using them. The circulation section links the books, resources and the readers. Whenever the book is used, then only the library is used effectively. So circulation section helps to do that, actually, right? So it supports the first two laws of library science. Please remember this. Circulation section supports the first two laws of library science. Ranganathan's law. This section ensures the use of books by readers by offering them issue return facilities. I already told you the main role of circulation function is to issue, return and renew books. So it is responsible for giving books to the users. It keeps records of what book has been given to which user and what has been returned and what is overdue. So these are the statistics and these are the records the circulation section will keep hold of, right? So what when the books are returned, the documents are returned back to the library, and it is a duty of the circulation section to put them back to, back on the appropriate shelf for the right places. So the user will take the book and return it to the circulation section. The circulation section should restore the book in the appropriate place, okay, from which shelf it has been taken. So there are different methods of circulation section, right? Circulation or register system, card system, automated system, which makes use of barcode technology. So some libraries use card system, some libraries use register system, and majority now most of the libraries are using automated system by using implementing any learning library management softwares like Sol, Koha, Libsys, Virtua, etc. Okay, so this section keeps record of all the registered users of the library, their transaction, loan period, borrowing privileges, etc. Okay, so circulation section keeps a database of list of users in the library as well as list of resources in the library. Okay, all the transactions. So if you want to get any data about which user is having taken maximum number of books, you can get it from circulation section. Similarly, which resource has been used to the maximum effect, you can take it from the circulation section. The circulation section serves as a data hub. Okay. So library, as I mentioned earlier, libraries procure document for readers. What is the meaning of procure? Procure is purchase. So they purchase for the readers only. So not just to keep the books in shelf, the readers have to take the book. For that, circulation section plays a link between reader and the resources in the library. So the document should be put to maximum use. It did satisfy the first two laws of library science that advocate that readers should get the books to meet their information needs. We already saw this in the selection of books, right? How to select books and book selection principles. We saw this, right? So circulation works refers to all activities performed and procedures adopted for registration of users. See, what are the functions they are doing? They are registering users, issue return of documents, maintenance of statistics, gate register, property counter and lockers. So these are the some of the functions of circulation section. But there are certain documents, maybe books or sources like encyclopedias, maps, dictionary in the libraries, which are not or lent or issued to the readers. That means they are not given. That means they are not issued to the readers. They are only kept for reference purposes. So those kind of documents are called as non-circulation documents. Some of these sources are encyclopedias, they won't issue it. Dictionaries, they won't issue it. They are designated only for reference purpose. In case any costly book with only rare book or only a single copy is available, that book, they won't issue it. Okay. So every library has a circulation desk or counter. In all the library, you will see the circulation desk, okay? It is generally located near the entrance of the library to monitor the students coming in and going out, and also to easy accessibility, right? So usually circulation section will be placed in the entrance of the library. It is a service point meant for issue and return of books, okay? So this is how a circulation section looks like in a library. This is a circulation desk and this is the counter, right? This is how a circulation section looks like in a library, in a normal library, okay? So there will be a trained staff who will do the issue, return and renewal of resources to the users, right? So these are the important points to remember regarding circulation services. What are they? Circulation section ensures use of books by readers by offering them to issue and return. So whatever I told you can be summarized using these 5 points. The main function of circulation section is to issue and return. It keeps record of all registered users of the library, their transaction, loan periods, borrowing privileges. That means whoever, in the case of university library, it keeps records of all the users. Who are the users in university library? Students, faculty, non-teaching staff, HODs, deans and whoever they are. So they will keep full records, okay? They also keep records of non-circulation documents like dictionaries, maps, journals, okay? The circulation desk or the counter is located near the entrance of the library. It is a service point meant for issue and return of books. So these are the key points regarding circulation section. Okay, this is how a circulation section will look like in a library. Okay, what are the aims of circulation section? So see, any efficient section aims at ensuring maximum use of library material by the users. That is true actually. The aim is to help the students to make use of the library. So you are purchasing books for the library in order to be made use by the students or the users, right? That should be the ultimate aim. So it does so. How does circulation fulfill this aim actually? By adopting proper procedures like systems for charging and discharging. You see here, charging and discharging, we don't call it as issue and return. In library terms, we call it as charging and discharging. Charging means issue, discharging means return. Remember that, okay? Charging and discharging. And maintaining relevant records. It aims at answering the following questions. So circulation section aims at answering the following question. If a particular book has been used or not, based on the statistics in the circulation section, based on the data available in the circulation section, you can able to find out these answers, okay? If a particular book has been used or not. So if you want to know about a particular book, like Cohen classification, this book has been used by any user or not, like that you can find out. If issued, to whom it has been issued, when is the due date for return, which books have not been returned in time, you can take. There are certain books which students may not return in time. One reason is student might have forgot about the due date. Other reason is if that same book is not returned by most of the students on due date, because that book is most important. You have to remind them. So because that book might be essential for that particular users, they forgot to renew or something like that. So they keep it. If the same book is not returned on time properly, and due to in some cases it might be due to lack of awareness and carelessness, or students might forget the due date. If many times it is happening, means that too only for a same book, means that book might be popular. So based on the statistics and the data, you can get all these answers to this particular set of questions. Statistics of issued books, which books have been issued most regularly, to whom a certain book is issued, identification of a particular reader, which reader takes more number of books, like that, which reader takes less number of books, how many books can a particular reader borrow, how many books are issued to a particular reader, for how many days a particular reader can keep a book, for how many days a particular book has been issued. Similarly, how many data you can take it. See, these are some kind of research questions. So based on the circulation section, you can answer these kind of research questions if you do an in-depth analysis, right? So how much overdue charges due from a particular reader, how much fine has been collected. So which reader has reserved a particular book. So how many books have been reserved by the readers. See, based on a simple statistics and simple data, which is maintained by the circulation section, you can answer n number of questions, okay. So hence circulation section, as I mentioned, is the hub, data hub of the library. If you want any data about the library, you have to go to the circulation section. Regarding the list of books available, regarding the number of users available, who comes to the library most, who takes books most, who's not using books most, every kind of data you can get it from the circulation section, right? So what is the scope of these services, circulation services? Registration of members. See, whenever a new student joins or new user joins, in case of a public library, anyone can become a member. You have to go in and you have to write an application form, and automatically they will enroll you as a member. Whereas in the case of academic library like school, college and university, the department will send the students and newly registered students list, and the library will prepare ID card, and the library will prepare the details, will enter the details in their software, and they will give the ID card. That is how the registration will carry out in circulation, right? And the maintenance of database. See, department wise database they can maintain, or the privileges wise, like students database, faculty database, non-teaching database, like that they can maintain, depending upon the nature of users. Charging and discharging, that means issue and return. Remember, next time I won't use issue and return. Charging and discharging is the terminology used for issue and return and renewal, okay. Recall, reservation. Recall in the sense, what do you mean by recall? If a book has been issued to a particular user or a particular student, the library has the right to recall the book. Even though the due date has not been arrived, still library has the right to recall. Don't, this book is needed urgently, bring it. You can ask that. And reservation, collection of overdue fines, maintenance of gate register, property counters and lockers. These are some of the scope for circulation services. The circulation services perform the following functions. Simple. So see, now we are coming to the systems. We already discussed in the introduction there are different systems like register system, card system, automated system, right? So we will see what are the different systems actually. So the first system is register system. We all know what is this register, right? It is a long note. They will keep a register and they will enter the daily transactions. Okay, daily transactions. How they will enter? By writing the author's name, title of the book, reader's name, to whom the book has been issued. So this method is not popular, but most of the libraries, like school libraries or some college libraries, they use this register system. For example, how they use this, in register, they will keep a note. Note or a big register. Now what they will do is, when a user takes a book, there will be no card or something. There will be no card. The user takes a book, they will write the register number of the user, and they will write the title of the book, and they will write the author name. Along with that, they will write the due date, and the user will sign it. Again, when the user returns the book, again the user again will sign for return date, and the librarian will countersign it. See, this is how the register system is maintained. Everything is written manually. Everything, you have to write it manually. Okay, the problem is, if that register is lost, if that page is damaged or something like that, you will not be in a position to track the status of the book, to whom this book has been issued. You have no idea unless the register is maintained properly, and it is very difficult to go back and come. You have to turn all the pages to see a loads of transaction, right? So this is one of the, what is a very difficult system. It is not very popular. So second is card system. Card means they will give a card. Now you are having a card, right? Library card. They will give a library card to all the users. That is card system. This is a system in which two cards are used. Remember, one card is for the book, known as the book card. Another card is for the borrower. Book card is usually kept in the book actually. They will write the accession number, call numbers or title of the book. There will be a small card. Another card is borrower card. Borrower card is user card. That is your card. So this card system is commonly followed by libraries. Yes, most of the libraries follow card system, right? So there are two types of card system, Brownian system and NEWAC system. So we will see what these two types of systems are. The first one is Brownian system. It was devised by Nina E. Brownie. It involves the following steps. For charging, what do you mean by charging? Issuing. Okay, remember, the book card is removed from the book. I have mentioned that book card, there are two cards, right? One is book card and one is borrower card. So book card, they will keep inside the book, that is inside the book packet. Okay, they will paste a book packet at the last of the, at the last at the end page of the book, and there will be a small book card, and they will keep inside the book indicating the accession number and call number or something. Okay, so now when the user is wanting, when the user is going to take that book, what they will do is the book card is removed. They will remove the book card from the book and place the book card into the student's ID card, that is borrower's ticket, which has his or her name, address, registration, ID number. The borrower ID card will contain student's name, address, registration number. I am telling students because it will be easier for you to understand. In the sense, it is user, okay? The borrower ticket, what is borrower tickets? ID card, student's library card, okay? With book card is filed under the date by the call number. So now borrower ticket in the student's ID card, in the student's ID card, the book card will be inserted and it will be filed under the date by the call number, okay? Now the day will, they will stamp the due date. The due date, when the user is supposed to return, that is the due date, 14 days now, is stamped on the due date slip. There will be a due date slip and they will stamp, they will seal it, okay? Due date slip, like now it's September 9, right? 14 days, 23 September they have to return, like that. They will stamp it and charge the book. Is after stamping it, they will give the book to the reader. So again, when the book is returned, the due date is checked. They will check the due date from the date slip. On what seal they have, on what is the seal, due date seal they have entered, because we will forget over a period of days. If the user returns after 12 days, means we will never, we can't able to identify. Only after seeing the due date slip, we will be able to identify, oh, this book is still due till 23rd, so he is returning on 21st, like that. So the book card with the borrower ticket, so now the book card with the borrower ticket is with the library only, right? So they will remove the book card from the borrower ticket, and what they do is they will give the ID card, they will give the borrower ticket to the user itself, and they will insert the book card into the book. Now the due date, issue date is cancelled on the due date slip and the borrower ticket is returned to the reader. Again, the book card, they will insert it into the book pocket. Simple. If the book card is returned after the due date, they will calculate the overdue fine and the reader will be asked to pay the fine accordingly. So this is how Brownie system works, card system, right? So these are some of the images of different samples used in Brownie charging system. I told you this is book packet, this is book packet, okay? This book packet, it will be inside the last page of the book, they will stick it, okay? Inside the packet, they will keep a book card like this, okay? Here the picture is big, don't worry, but it will be small only. For your visibility, I have made this picture a little bit big. So this book packet, there will be a hole, okay? In the book packet, they will keep the book card inside, okay? So when the user is asking for the book, so this is the borrower ticket. That means library ID card of the user. Borrower ticket is nothing but library ID card of the user, okay? So this is your user ID card, okay? So in this also there will be a hole, okay? Once you are planning to take a book, means you have to give this card to the library. What they will do, they will take this book card from the book packet and they will insert this book packet into your borrower card, into your borrower ticket, so that they will able to understand that this book has been taken by this user. Similarly, in the date slip, what they will do is this slip will also be pasted in the last page of the book, okay? In the last page of the book, they will seal September 23, 2020, that is the return date. So when you return the book, they will check the date slip to ensure that you have book, return the book on time, okay? So these are the different samples used in Brownie charging system, okay? The next is Newark. So Newark also, it's a card based system only. It contains borrowers and book cards. So borrowers cards is nothing but library ID card given to the user, okay? Whatever card you are having, that is borrower card. And book card, whatever book card is, we saw that, right? This is a book card that will be kept, it will be prepared for each and every book, okay? Remember that. The book packet, it is pasted in the book, okay? Now in the automated system, they are not doing that. Manually, they were doing all these things. You have to prepare book card and you have to paste everything. Everything stationary is lot of stationary and lot of meticulous work actually. So again, for charging, charging is issuing. The due date is stamped on the due date slip. Similarly, we saw due date slip. The due date, that is the return date. Okay, that is the due date. Again, it is stamped on the book card and the borrower card. See, this is the difference. Here, in Brownie system, the due date is stamped only in the date slip. But here, they are stamping both on book card as well as in student's ID card. So, that is the difference here. So, borrower's ID number is written opposite to the date in the book card and filed behind the concerned date guide card. Okay. That means, the borrower's ID number, what is the ID number, roll number of the students or library ID number, whatever ID number they are given, it is written opposite the date. It is written adjacent to the date in the book card. Okay. So when we see the image, you will understand. When the book is returned, the date of return stamp on the borrower, the date of return is stamped on the borrower's card. Similarly, that is because here the return date is, the due date is 23, but you are returning on 20th itself. They will stamp 20. In Brownie system, it is not like that. They will just check it and they will just give it. If it is before the, what is it? If it is before the due date, they will just give the card to you. If it is after the due date, they will calculate the fine. Here it is not like that. They are pasting the due date both on borrower's card, on borrower's ticket and book card, and also on due slip. And whenever you are returning, they are inserting a return date stamp also. That means the due date is 23, but you are returning on 20. They will insert the 20 also. See how many data they are inserting. Again, the book card is taken out from the circulation file from the date on the date slip and placed on the book packet. Similarly, the book card will be taken from the circulation cabinet and they will ensure that the book is returned on time. Again, they will place the book card into the book packet. If the book is returned after the due date, they will calculate the fine and the fine has to be paid by the reader. So these are the samples of NEWAC system. So see, this is the date slip. This is the date slip. Here in Brownie, this is the date slip, book packet, book card, borrower's ticket. Okay, here you come here. This is the date slip. Okay, so this is the book packet. This is the book packet. Here in book packet, they have given the rules of the library as well. I have given the rules of the library as well. In Brownie, it is not like that. This book packet will be pasted at the end of the book. Remember that, okay? So here you see the book card. Here you see the book card. Here in the book card, they will write all these details and it will be inserted in the book packet. Again, the book was issued on the stamped. Here also they are stamping the due date. See. But whereas in the case of Brownie, they are not stamping here anyway. They are not stamping the due date here. But in the case of NEWAC system, they are stamping. That means for every book, you have to have more than 5 to 10 cards. Then only you can, if the book is taken again, means there should be a new book card. Okay, you cannot use the same book card. There should be a new book card. So here, this is the borrower's ID card, that is your student ID card, okay? See the date of expiry, and here also date of return is there. Date of return is there. That means when you return it, they will seal it. See how many details are. Both are same only. Both are using two card system only, borrower card and book card. But the procedure is little bit different, okay? So both falls under card system, okay? Fine. So nowadays, most of the libraries are not using this, because you have to stick this book packet, and you have to prepare book card, and you have to prepare this card according to this format, and everything is there, right? So nowadays, with the technology, they are not using, they are not doing these kind of meticulous work, right? So now we are going to look how technology has replaced most of this card based and register based systems. We are going to discuss automated circulation system. I have told you about automation, right? Whatever work which is done with the help of a machine or a computer is called automation, right? In automation system, the manual system of operation is replaced, okay, with computer-based system of operation. No manual work, like in register, they won't write anything, okay? Everything is done with the help of a computer. In the system, library has a web-based catalog that is opaque. What do you mean by web-based catalog? That is opaque. So, OPAC, what does the OPAC have? It has a collection of books, journals, they are availability in the library, registers, a list of registered users, everything is maintained in that OPAC and the database, okay? This is all maintained through LMS, Library Management Software, okay? There are many advantages of using this, automated circulation system. The catalog displays what the library has and users can access from it anywhere. That is a good advantage actually. The user can just look into the OPAC and they can access it anywhere. They need not to come to the library every time, okay? The users can easily check their account. Now we are using CPU library, right? You can check your account, how many books you have borrowed, what is your borrow history, everything. You can check your account. Okay, what has been issued to them, which are overdue and which can renew, and what books they can renew, everything. There is no need for the library to issue and maintain borrowers cards or tickets. You need not to issue any separate library ID card or something. Every member requires a single card. A single card is enough that can be used as your college ID card or even as a library ID card, okay? With the unique identification number, such as any number like library membership number, to be used by the software to access a member database. Here the unique identification number is our roll number, okay? Or some other number the library gives, okay? Depending upon what the library decides, that one card is more than enough, okay? That multiple borrowing facilities are controlled by the software. That means while register system, you might have forgotten, right? This user have already taken, the limit is for two books means, already if you have taken two books means, in manual it will be difficult to ascertain whether the students have taken. You have to go through all the register, all the records, right? But in the software, it will automatically limit it. Yes, he has already borrowed two books and the limit is over. You cannot borrow the third book unless he returns one book. So see the advantages of automated circulation system, right? So this is how the automated circulation system will look like. This is how the card will be like, along with the photos and everything, right? The validity and the barcode and everything. So the circulation module of automated system performs the following functions: handling of again lending, return, renewal, putting on hold, sending reminders, and controls circulation type, location, status, user database, profiles, privileges, computation, payment of overdue fines, etc. So these are the things, whatever manual we do, it will control same only, but it will be easier to monitor all these things in an automated system. And it also has some additional features like import, export, backup and restore functions for the database, right? You can import and export records. That is very easy using a software. I have told you about EZ39.50, right? EZ39.50. You can import from other databases, right? That is very easy. Usage statistics. Within a fraction of a second, you can print all the usage statistics. That is very much. In manual, you cannot do it. It is very difficult. Here, you within a fraction of a second, you can print it, right? And has an option to generate and print barcode identicals. In automated system, you have an option to generate and print barcode identity cards. I have told you about barcode, right? You can print that also. So this is how a barcode ID card will look like. So as soon as a list of, again, this is the procedure adopted for charging and discharging through automated system, that is issuing and return. So new list of students admitted into various courses in our university, what they will do? The data will be fed into the computer software. For that, you have to do a manual data entry, okay? That is the only work you are doing manually. You have to enter the details of the students, their departments and everything, the number of books to be issued and everything. So, and barcode are generated. There will be option in all the software, there will be an option for generating barcode. Now with all the software, they are having that option. These barcode cards can be laminated too by the library. Barcode labels are prepared for books also. For using accession number as key fields, instead of this number, they will use as accession number. Simple. Instead of this for student, they will use member ID number. Simple. Depending upon the nature and the size of the data, we can print barcode. We saw that in the barcode itself, right? In the computerized circulation system, which uses barcode technology, the borrower presents the before the counter his or her library card and the books which he wants to borrow. That means the user will go to the library, they will take the book which he or she wants to borrow, and they will present the book as well as the card. That is what we are doing, right? To the circulation counter. Again, a barcode is an optical machine readable representation of data, it shows data about the object to which it is attached. That means this code saves, I have discussed about this, is 95, what do you say, columns, saves data about the object to which it has been mapped or saved. Okay, here in the case one, for students it stores the students data, user data. In the case of books, it stores the accession number, it stores the accession number, title, author and other details of the book. Okay, so here a barcode, for reading barcode you must have a scanner. Okay, there should be a scanner to read barcode, right? Or else you can't read it. So there should be a scanner, should be bought, and scanner is used for reading barcode from the borrower's card and the book. What do you mean by borrower card? Borrower card is nothing but user identity card, that is your library card, simple. Okay, so when a book is issued to a borrower, the counter staff scans the barcode membership from the member ID card. Okay, that means the using the scanner, the library staff who is in the circulation section will scan the member ID card to based on the card. You need not to tell your name and anything, just based on the card they will scan, and all the details about that member will appear in the computer screen. Similarly, they will again scan the details about the book using that barcode scanner, and the details about the book will be appearing in the screen. Automatically they will click issue. This is how barcode technology is used effectively in circulation section. Okay, so these are the charging and discharging using what you call automated system. This is how a scanner will look like. See, this is how a scanner will look like. The only disadvantage here is you have to place, what you say, there should be line of contact. That means the barcode should be placed near, exactly in line to the scanner. You cannot keep it, what you say, separately behind or front. Exactly it should be in the line, then only it will read. Even a single line misses, you cannot, the data will not be correct. So this is how they are reading. See, just they are keeping the book in line with the barcode scanner. Automatically it takes data and it feeds in the computer. Okay. So again, now we are going to see one more technology, RFID. It is an advanced version. It is not like barcode. It is an advanced. It uses tags. It is a radio frequency identification technology, which uses radio waves as a signal to communicate, right? So RFID tags are small IC, that is integrated circuits, which are scanned with a radio transmitter. So no line of sight or direct contact with the tags is required to read them. That means here you see there is line of sight. That means the book and the barcode and the scanner are kept in single line. When you keep the barcode, when you want to read the barcode, you have to take the book or the ID card near the scanner. RFID, it is not like that. You can keep it from a distance itself. Depending upon the bandwidth and depending upon the range the waves cover, let it be 10 feet or let it be 5 feet, whatever bandwidth you are purchasing, even at a certain distance, it will automatically read the data. That is the advantage of it. No line of sight. See, there is no line of sight or direct contact with the tag is required. Here, barcode will not be there. Instead of barcode, there will be a tag, RFID tag. So it is used by some libraries for issue and return of documents. And not only for that, RFID is used for many purposes. It prevents theft actually. Primarily in RFID is used in many sectors, in medical, in e-commerce industry, shopping, whatever it may be, they are using this RFID to good effect. For shopping and other things, the primary purpose is to avoid theft. Similarly, for us also, we can use this to avoid theft and also to monitor, and also for effective retrieval of books. The only thing, advantage of RFID is, in barcode technology, what happens is, the library staff has to be present to issue the book. RFID is not like that. Without the help of a library staff, the student automatically can take the book. Okay, that is a unique advantage of RFID. There is no need to be having a physical presence of library staff. There is a self-issue kiosk. So they will place the book. They will place the book in that and the ID card in that. Automatically it tags and automatically it will issue. Okay. So even for returning also, there is no need for the library staff to be present. They will just place it. Automatically it will drop. The book will drop in the kiosk. So that is what you can do with the RFID system. There is no need for, what you say, there is no need for physical person in the circulation counter. So at present, some of the libraries, in my library, I have implemented RFID actually while I was working. So it requires lots of fund and it requires lots of time also. Once you implement it, the work will be very easy and it will be streamlined because you have to paste the tags properly. At present, some of the libraries are using this RFID technology for circulation procedure. It is a combination of radio frequency based and microchip technology. So the books have RFID tags in place of barcodes. There will be no barcode, nothing. Only RFID tag will be there. They will read for every RFID tag. Contains data about this book, okay? So whatever object you are placing this tag, it will contain the data. It stores information relating to the specific item to which has been fixed. Here we are fixing this tag to book only. So it contains data about the book. You can enter the data. It holds data about identification of the document, proof of ownership, everything. Whatever data you give, it will hold it, okay? It is very thin and it can be put between pages and the readers remains unaware of it. Okay. In the barcode, you have to stick either in the front. You cannot stick inside the book. That is a very disadvantage because it will be difficult for the scanner to read the barcode if you stick inside. So barcode, there is chance that student will tear the barcode. Once the barcode sticker is torn, the scanner will not read it. RFID is not like that. You can paste it anywhere. It will be a small tag. Okay, without knowledge of the user, you can paste it. It can be plugged out, but it is not very easy. And that is a unique advantage, okay? So these are the components of RFID technology. RFID tags, as I have told you, it is a small tag which is placed inside the book. It holds data about details about the book. And there will be a reader. Similarly, for any tag or what you say, any technology, there should be a reader, right? So because you are having a tag, there should be some reader to read the data what is stored in the tag, right? Similarly, like barcode scanner, there will be RFID reader scanner. So it reads data stored, then only you can see the output, or else the data will be inside. Line of sight is not required. That is a more important advantage. And there is a disadvantage also. What happens is, if you keep five to six books, what do you say? Line by line, it will read all the six books simultaneously. That is a disadvantage, but you have to see monitor it carefully. Instead of reading one by one like barcode, you can read six books within a fraction of seconds. 100 books within a fraction of second if you keep one by one above. And barcode is not like that. You have to take the book, you have to keep the barcode scanner near the barcode, then only it will read. It is not like that. If you just place the book here, it will automatically read. So computers are required. Similarly, for displaying the output and you can connect the RFID equipment to the computer or a network, to a single computer or a group of computer, depending upon where you want to work or where you want to check the output or something like that. See, as I mentioned, self-check-in and self-checkout. I told you, right, there is no need for library staff to be present in RFID technology. Users can automatically take the book, automatically they can issue themselves, automatically they can return, automatically like a receipt, automatically there will be a receipt will print. These points will have computers where the readers can check in and check out by themselves without the help of any library staff. Exit gates are there. Exit gates with sensors. That means in our library we are having, right? They are RFID only. When you take the book without issuing, what will do? It will create an alarm sound. Okay. That means the book has not properly issued. Application software. There is a software for this. It can be connected with the library automation software. Okay, RFID has a separate software and you have to connect it with if you are using Koha, means you can connect it with it. Okay. It is stored on a server. It has all the data. Here the data is very easy. You can take it. The software interfaces RFID system to transmit and receive the data. Okay. So RFID system is what you say. It is very good and very robust. But the thing is, it is expensive. When you compare to barcode, it is very expensive. So this is how a normal RFID system looks like. Okay. So when we go to the library, I will exactly show you what is RFID, what is RFID tag and how they are using it, okay? So this is how it supports self-check-in and self-checkout. I think our library doesn't have self-check-in and self-checkout. Though they can do it, but they are not doing it. That means you have to keep a kiosk. Self-check-in kiosk means automatically the student will keep. Punjab University, Chandigarh library is having that. You can just keep the book and the card, okay? Automatically, the book, the date and the username card will be mapped and the data will be stored on the server. Anytime, you know, the library staff can check it, okay? So today, how many books has been issued? Like that, okay? Since you are having RFID, there is no fear of theft. No one can take the book outside the library without issuing. So that is very safe, okay? So automatically they can issue. They just have to keep the book on the RFID scanner reader. Automatically it will read it and it will print a receipt also. This book has been issued. Everything is connected. So some of the points to remember is RFID, the acronym, the expansion of the acronym is radio frequency identification. No line of sight. Remember this, this is very important advantage. That means that there is no need to have direct contact between the RFID tag and the scanner, like barcode, okay? For reading or scanning the tags, it supports self-issue. Barcode with, in barcode, self-issue is not possible. Self-return is also not possible. It offers security to theft, okay? So these are the common keywords you should know. What do you mean by check-in and check-out? Return. Check-in means return. Check-out means borrow. Okay. Check-in. Check-in. Return. Borrow. Circulation. What is circulation? All the activities and procedures related to lending and return of books. Lending, issuing, charging, all are same only. Okay. Circulation desk. A counter at the entrance of the library where the students check-in or check-out. Okay, holds. What do you mean by holds? Checked out books which are kept on reserve for readers. Okay, holds. You can hold it. You can reserve it. You can reserve it. Some books have been issued, right? Some book has been issued. Another user is asking for the same book. Means you can. That student is not allowed to renew the book. You have to return it because another student has requested it. That means you are keeping the book in hold. Renewal. You all know what is renewal, right? Students can get the loan period extension of loan period. Okay. So kindly go through these references for a detailed and comprehensive understanding. These references are used to prepare this particular PPT. Thank you, man. Thank you.